were making pathways to their Isis and Osiris, their gods of afterlife and resurrection, and gods from their beginning.
The Egyptians emphatically believed in a golden age when the gods ruled the earth. Four children came out of the womb of the sky goddess, four human-shaped children, two of which were Isis and Osiris, and they established a kingdom of the first time. They called it Zeptepi. This was a golden age when the gods ruled the earth and brought knowledge and civilization. The balance between the cosmos and the earth was perfect, and happiness ruled the land.
A golden time in which Osiris ruled. But Seth, his brother, grew jealous, betrayed and killed Osiris. The world fell prey to chaos as Seth cut up the body of Osiris and hid each of its 14 pieces. Blood and darkness came over Egypt. But Isis, faithful consort of Osiris, searched every corner of the land, gathered the parts of her beloved, and bound them in linen.
However, she could not find the phallus, and she fabricated a golden phallus from which she impregnated herself with the seed of Osiris and bore a son, the son Horus, the divine child. It is Horus that became the first established man god, first pharaoh, to rule Egypt, and all pharaohs that followed believed themselves to be reincarnated entities of Horus.
Horus with the falcon head avenged his father, conquered evil, and slew Seth. And Isis and Osiris reincarnated in heaven, where both stand as rulers of the night and afterlife. Osiris as Orion, and Isis as the star Sirius.
One cannot overemphasize the importance of the star Sirius. Sirius was Isis, the life-giving force of Egypt. The star performs a very, very specific cycle. It is not only the brightest star in the northern hemisphere, in the whole sky. It wasn't because the star was beautiful and brilliant that the Egyptian venerated it, but it would disappear. Orion and Sirius would disappear for a period of 70 days. Now this is extremely interesting, because the period of 70 days was also the period of embalmment, when they would mummify a king. They would take 70 days to perform the ritual, and therefore it's clear that they associated it to the disappearance of the stars for 70 days. 70 days they waited in mourning, and in expectation, and in fear that the star would not reappear and Egypt would not be reborn again. But then on a magical day that occurred at the summer solstice, 70 days later, the star would pop over the eastern horizon this time at dawn, just a few seconds before sunrise. And this spark of life, of the appearance of the star, was the greatest moment in the Egyptian cultic belief.
For at that same moment, the River Nile swelled from monsoon rains in a distant, unknown south. The Nile floods brought new life to a parched land. For Egypt, this was the yearly rebirth, so crucial that it took it as the start of its new year.
This miraculous conjunction of summer solstice sunrise, of the rebirth of Sirius at dawn after this long invisibility, and the flooding of the Nile was the great vision that the Egyptians had about rebirth. And they imagined their god Osiris in the sky, looking down on his creation, looking down on Egypt, looking down at the rising of the star. And the creation that he sees is not only the star rising, but the rebirth of Egypt. And this spark of life was, in their mind, transferable to the goddess Isis giving birth to Horus, the divine child which represented Egypt. So it is the star that encapsulates the very essence of Egypt, the very essence of its yearly rebirth. Now, here we have a divine mother bearing the divine child associated to a star in the east. Interestingly, the same concept appears again 3,000 years later in a completely new cult. Or is it a completely new cult?
Boval's insights shed new light on the magical death rites for the pharaoh, child of Horus, as the builders of the pyramids envisaged. After 70 days, the mummy was taken west to the land across the Nile, the Giza necropolis. As one crosses the Milky Way to Orion's belt, where the pyramids stand as the gateway to Isis and Osiris, gods of life after death.
I'm taking you inside the Pyramid of Unas. Here are the oldest religious writings in history, the pyramid texts. The meaning of these texts were nearly forgotten because Egyptologists saw in them mainly a sun religion. But this isn't a religion of the day and the living. This is a religion of the night and of the dead. These texts repeatedly tell us that the king becomes a star in the kingdom of Osiris, in the constellation of Orion. One of these texts says, may you traverse the winding waterway, the Milky Way, and may you go to the place where Orion is. Now, when a pharaoh died, his body was mummified and prepared like Osiris, and his soul was ready to ascend to the sky. But before this would happen, the dead king had to ensure that the power of divine rule was passed on to his son, the living Horus. This would happen in a very dramatic ceremony called the opening of the mouth, during which ceremonial tools were used to open the mouth of the mummy and bring it back to life. Then an artificial phallus was placed on the mummy, and the dead king was directed towards the star of Isis, the star Sirius. It was then that the sealing of the womb of the goddess took place. His earthly mission fulfilled, and the dead king would depart to the sky. In effect, what we have here is a reenactment of the resurrection myth of Osiris, told in stellar terms.
In ancient Egypt, this was Rostau, entrance to the underworld, kingdom of Osiris and gateway to afterlife, a place where mystery reigns up until today. So far, scientists saw little more than tombs for three dead pharaohs, but the realization grows that this was much, much more. Deep in this shaft, Egypt's top archaeologist is excavating corridors and caves which bring the Osiris myth further alive.
This has become a sacred place to the Egyptians. People wanted to be buried here, to be connected with this god Osiris. We are now 30 meters underneath the ground, between the Sphinx exactly and the second pyramid. We found remains of four pillars like this one. In between, there is water. Underneath the water, there is a sarcophagus. Above the sarcophagus was that lid. When I looked inside the sarcophagus, we did not find anything. But why? He's not buried here. But symbolically, his spirit. His spirit is here. They could know that this is the tomb of Osiris. And this really is a symbolic burial, a cenotaph for Osiris. And it's very unique, and it became legend later that many people will be having a small statue made of wood and their erection in it, and they mummify this, and erection means resurrection, because Osiris is the cut of resurrection. He was killed by the devil, Seth, but Isis cried her tear mid the river Nile, and she restored his erection that she could not find, and she had the son from him, Horus the victorious, who conquered the devil. This myth built the Egyptian civilization. Without Isis, there is no river Nile. The river Nile gave fertility to the land. Without the river Nile, there is no Egypt. And also, the story tells us the devil always has to be conquered.
Much more than tombs for dead pharaohs, this was the grandiose expression of a civilization with a cosmic vision that probed death and reached for resurrection through magical rites and initiation.
The whole focus of the Egyptian cult, the whole idea of the initiatory cult, of the mystical cult, is to learn how to perform this transfiguration and journey into the afterlife and become part of the Osirian afterlife kingdom. Osiris was in the constellation of Orion. They called this Sahu. Strangely enough, the name Sahu means to become a spiritual being, an astral being. They gave the name to the mummy. We have named mummies, mummies. But the mummy in ancient Egypt was called Sahu. To become a Sahu is to become a mummy, but it's also to become a spiritualized entity, to become Orion. The same way we say to join Christ or to become Christ-like after death.
Are the Giza pyramids an attempt to reach beyond death? New insights gain ground.
They were an actual model on the ground of the region of the sky through which your soul is expected to travel. So they were a place of initiation, a place of preparation into the mystery of what lies beyond death. I believe that they were primarily intended to be experienced by the living and to have a transformatory effect upon the living, from which they would emerge stronger and more equipped for this terrible and terrifying journey that must be made after death. That, to me, makes sense of the whole enterprise.
Initiated into the mysteries of silence and stillness, the one thing you were never allowed to do was to talk about it. And oddly enough, no one ever did. All we know is that they passed through the portals of death. If you like, a preview of death, it was being taken through anything which involves the emotions, both fear, panic, love, simply to push this person to the point where they break through all that is not truly them, so that the true person beneath the social overlay can emerge.
A place where men stood eye to eye with a god. Thousands of years before Christianity, ancient Egypt knew of a last judgment. Man's sins are weighed against what he truly is, the feather of truth, his essence, the lightness that remains when he has shed all else. This was a civilization that quested for a truth within.
You know, today, our worldview by our scientists tell us that the truth is out there and we have to search outside. But to the ancient Egyptians, they said that the truth was in here and the search was within, inside. They believed that inside the individual is the spark of divinity. And in order to teach themselves inwardly, to expand that spark, to bring it to its full maturity, they had to speak to it internally
in a language that they call the language of divinity, the language of the gods. Now, how do they perceive this language? Well, the cosmos, if they are part of it, then they must communicate with it. They communicate by sensing, by getting messages from the wind, the stars, the moon, the fertility of the land, the birth of their children. This is the language of nature. This is the language of the cosmos. But they began to understand that you could convert, codify this language in a sacred language of symbols. You could symbolize cosmic principles. This is the beginning of sacred writing. This is why writing was invented. Indeed, they tell us that the invention of the sacred writing was from the gods.
Thought, God with the ibis head, God of knowledge, divine messenger, who taught the magic symbols of writing. It was Thought who initiated Isis into the magic of reincarnation. The Frenchman Champollion deciphered the hieroglyphs with this Rosetta Stone, but did he do justice to the magic of Thought, or are we, with our phonetic alphabet of 26 letters, just scratching the surface?
The Egyptians had a better system. The Egyptians, for one thing, had 780 letters in the writings, and they studied every single one of them. And each sign, each symbol was charged. So when they conveyed an idea, they chose the right symbol, the right sign. One very good example that we all know is the cross. The Christian cross is a symbol. If you are not aware of what it represents, then all you see is a cross. But of course, to a Catholic priest, initiated into the cult of Christianity, a cross signifies everything about Christianity. So rather than think of this as some sort of superstitious mumbo-jumbo, the hieroglyphics are the window behind which lies a whole powerful initiatory cult.
In the same sense, Egyptians would make little of this symbol into which every Catholic is initiated. The mystery of Eucharist. Beauvoir believes that ancient Egypt spoke in symbols, and that their magic may still speak to us today, even if we fail to understand it. In the centuries after the Pyramid Age, 2500 BC, religious concepts blurred as different gods dominated different epochs. But the Osiris myth withstood the time, even as the name Osiris eventually changed into Serapis.
Temples of Serapis and Isis could be found as far as England, Germany, temples in France.
As from the first century AD, the cult spread throughout the Roman Empire to vie for supremacy, with Christianity on the rise. And it even influenced Christianity itself.
Within the Christian movement developed a faction that had absorbed the idea that in order to attain divine state, one had to acquire knowledge through the internal search. This very much came from the ancient Egyptian initiated religion.
Alexandria, Egypt, a place of initiation for adherents of an old faith and a new one. Here, early Christians came to find gnosis, knowledge from the heart through initiation. For that they needed no church, no hierarchy, only to face themselves and meet God.
This, in a sense, represents the underworld, the tenebrous regions where initiates and make contact with the divinities. It is light getting into darkness and finding a way into the afterlife kingdom. The portals of immortality, the portals that led to an afterlife, was through death. And therefore the initiates would come down here in absolute black darkness, perhaps with no torches whatsoever, and would come here and imbue the mood of the place and find themselves in a peculiar position of interface. They were that close, they believed, where one can transit from life, death, and rebirth. The people who came here were early Christians, and yet they were the link between the ancient Egyptian mystery cults and the Gnostic religion. The Gnostic religion is, in a sense, the ancient Egyptian mystery cult Christianized. So here we have the resurrection events performed through the mummification rituals. We see Anubis over the mummy. Thoth, now called Hermes by the Greeks. Here we are in the second century of Christianity. And yet we see early Christians perform the rituals of the ancient Egyptians, presenting the feather of truth, the symbol of truth, to the divinity. And this was a time when Christianity had not yet formulated its iconography or its symbols or even its myth.
Christianity shape its myth? Of the four Gospels, there's one which has shaped our idea of nativity. Mary is the holy mother of a divine child, Jesus, and strangely links the story to Egypt, the Gospel of Matthew.
The Matthew Gospel is unique for three things, all related to the nativity story. One, the Magi. They come from the east and they follow a star. That's the second thing. The star of the east. Thirdly, he has the Holy Family escaping to Egypt, the massacre of the infants by Herod, and coming to Egypt and taking refuge at Heliopolis.
A Christian church near Heliopolis depicts the Holy Family's escape to Egypt.
And the tradition is so much alive today that when they did this painting, they modeled the tree on the one that supposedly the Holy Family rested. This story appears in only one gospel, the Gospel of Matthew. Now we know that the Gospel of Matthew was written in the city of Alexandria in Egypt. So what did the writer have in mind?
Beauval believes Matthew developed the icon of the Holy Mother and the Divine Child to speak to the Egyptians, to whom that icon was more than familiar.
What is the most powerful icon of ancient Egyptian religious cult is indeed this goddess Isis holding the divine infant on her lap. They're trying to market a new religion here, a new divine child, to people who have believed for three millennia that the divine child was the divine child of Isis. He actually, in a sense, hijacked the stellar myth of Isis and Horus and the star Sirius and grafted it on the Christian mythology.
There is yet an even more powerful way that the ancient Christian myth makers injected the Isis myth into their new religion. They made use of a star, the star of the east, the star of Bethlehem. Could this star be the star of Isis, ancient star of divine birth?
After 3,000 years, due to the phenomena of precession, the time of rising and setting of Sirius changed. At the time of the birth of Jesus, that star would appear at around the time of the winter solstice, not the summer solstice as the ancient Egyptian, around the 25th of December to be precise, just after sunset. Now, we know that the Jews and Christians celebrated the changing of the day at dusk, not at dawn, like the ancient Egyptian, at sunset. Therefore, here is the interesting thing. On the 25th of December, they would see the constellation of Orion rising, and just after sunset, the star Sirius would rise over the horizon. And this was the very same image that the ancient Egyptians had seen for thousands of years to celebrate the birth of the divine child Horus.
So could it be that the star of the Nativity be drawn from an ancient myth and grafted onto the new religion of Christianity?
and were even the three magi setting out for the birth star, shaped to suit with ancient myth in Egypt.
The constellation of Orion, with the three bright stars forming the belt, would rise as if heralding, as if announcing the birth of Sirius. Now, it is only Matthew who mentions the magi in his gospel. Could this explain why the three stars in Orion's belt were identified to the three magi?
It's evident if you study the myth and the history together that those who wrote it saw Isis in the mother of Jesus. And then later on, she developed her own identity as Mary, and the Isis part of her withdrew. But certainly, originally, it was Isis. These mythic images are alive, and they evolve and change. And so nothing can be static, and nothing can be said that is the way it is for one time and one time only.
In its first centuries, Christianity is torn by theological debate. An Orthodox church with a growing hierarchy of priests and bishops confronts Gnostics who seek God within themselves. The fundamentals of faith are contested, the nature of Christ as God's Son fiercely debated.
God was not always the Father, once he was not.
Being agnostic meant being against the Orthodox Church, because the Gnostic did not recognize the established Church. He did not need the establishment. He communicated directly with God. He did not need an interpreter.
A faith of individuals, which is drawing increasing interest.
At its heart is the principle of relationship with divinity. Personal, no priest, no hierarchy, no administrative phenomenon, no leader. It's dangerous. It's dangerous to power structures, fatally dangerous.
Nicaea 325 AD. Constantine, the first Roman emperor to embrace Christianity, has called the bishops. As a statesman, he opts for orthodoxy and the support of a powerful hierarchy.
Fellow ministers, we believe in one God.
What he decrees will define the Christian faith until today.
And in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, begotten from the Father, God from God.
The Gnostic Gospels burned. Christians kill fellow Christians by countless thousands. Gnostics and everything pagan are wiped out. The Serapeum, Alexandria's Temple of Osiris, and its great library go up in flames.
And what replaced the system of knowledge and gnosis was blind faith, which eventually led to the monks and ascetic and dryness of an establishment that imposed their doctrines and dogmas on the population. We're now at the most incredible crossroad of world culture. Here is Philae, where the last stand of Egyptian culture and Egyptian religion stands, the great temple of Isis. The Christian mobs finally make their way here with their hammers and their chisels, and they throw themselves on the what they consider to be the pagan image and start chiseling. And the priests beg them, stop, stop, this is the most sacred temple of Egypt. This is the temple of the mother goddess. Thousands of years, your mother goddess. You have a mother goddess, you have your own. And they beg the monks to take over this temple and use it as a Christian sanctuary. And here we have it all. In a desperate bid to save the cult of Isis, the Egyptian priests stepped aside and let the new religion absorb its iconography and symbols.
At the close of antiquity, last survivors entrust the Gnostic Gospels and the ancient philosophies to paper and hide it for their persecutors. The Gnostic religious texts have surfaced only recently. The philosophical texts emerge much earlier in Florence, cradle of Europe's reawakening.
In 1460,
A monk delivered to Cosimo de' Medici a bundle of books. They turned out to be the Hermetica, the lost works of Hermes Trismegistos, the Egyptian thought. Cosimo asked his translator, Marsilio Ficino, to put aside Plato and translate forthwith the Hermetica. An intellectual bomb was about to explode. Hermetism became so popular that even the Pope Borgia decorated his apartments at the Vatican with scenes of Osiris and Isis and Thoth Hermes, as imagined by the Renaissance painters. Here, a religion was insinuating itself that was altered and deemed by some wiser than that of Moses in the Bible.
The Cathedral of Siena shows this image of Hermes Trismegistos, the god Thoth, handing over Egypt's wisdom, and the phoenix of creation, an ancient Heliopolis. The popes sprinkle Rome with symbols of antiquity and obelisks from Egypt.
By a strange twist of fate, the Pope chose the ancient symbol of Heliopolis, which was a pillar and a cross on top of it, and placed it in the very heart of Christendom. And how ironic that all who come here also admire this symbol of pagan Egypt.
Scholars like the Jesuit Athanasius Kircher study the Egyptian enigmas, but the church senses danger. Hermeticism inspires new individual ways away from the interests of the church. Ideas are banned, books burnt. In 1600, Hermeticism is silenced as its main proponent, Gordiano Bruno, is dragged before ecclesiastical courts and, despite cruel torture, refuses to renounce his ideas.
The church had only one way to stop this, and so the unthinkable happened. On a dull September morning, Giordano Bruno was dragged to this place, his mouth gagged, and he was burnt alive. Up to the very last moment, he tried to avert his eyes from the cross that was being brandished to his face by the Inquisition priests. And with this, Hermeticism took a nosedive and went deep underground.
Hermeticism finds refuge in esoteric societies such as Rosicrucians or Freemasonry. The Grand Lodge of London, heart and headquarters of Freemasonry, resonates with ancient symbols. Initiation in secrets, rites and symbols. Ask any Freemason about links with ancient Egypt, and they'll probably laugh it off. Authors Bob Lomas and Chris Knight would have done just that until curiosity got the better of them.
10 years ago, we would have poo-pooed anybody that said what we're saying now. But it's not a straight linear event, but there is a line straight back to Egypt that merged and branched off and rebranched back.
The pyramid with the all-seeing eye, the blazing star, did Egypt's most sacred symbols find their way in Masonic mysteries? In their books, Lomas and Knight investigate the influence of Freemasonry on symbols and institutions of America.
The founders of the United States of America, the majority of them, George Washington, Franklin and others, were Freemasons. At the construction of the White House, they attended there in all their Masonic regalia. And the Constitution of the United States is an extension of the principles of Freemasonry, of democracy and investment in science and the furtherance of science. It's a Masonic experiment, which in turn is an ancient Egyptian experiment, the principle of doing good for goodness sake, and outside of a religion. And that's what Freemasonry is today.
In front of the George Washington Masonic Temple stands another familiar symbol. Here, Washington and other founding fathers are honored carrying a Mason's apron. The dollar, symbol of America's might, shows the unknown side of the American seal, the pyramid with the all-seeing eye and the promise of a new order.
It's interesting, for example, that when the president is sworn in, he makes a Masonic symbol, which I can't demonstrate to you because it would contravene my vows as a Freemason. He doesn't explain what it is, but he makes a symbol, and that symbol is the Masonic symbol of fidelity.
So this man also didn't do it just to keep his fingers warm. Napoleon stepped on the world scene as conqueror of Egypt.
When Napoleon came to the gates of Cairo, he did not come as a Christian. He and his army were much imbued with a revolutionary cult that was modeled on Masonic ideals.
Virtually all his generals were Freemasons, and Napoleon himself was initiated during a night he passed alone inside the Great Pyramid.
Napoleon, when he returned from Egypt, was obsessed with the idea that he was under the protection of a star. So much so that this monument, known as the Place de l'Étoile, the place of the star, was put along the central axis of Paris, the Champs-Élysées, and more.
This great artery of Paris lies 26 degrees off east to align it with the Star of Isis, Beauval believes.
This is what the Parisians would see when they looked east, the constellation of Orion rising, and here is the star Sirius just breaking over the horizon, 26 and a half degrees to the right of east, in perfect alignment with the axis of the Champs-Élysées.
Some historians say that the name of Paris may be linked to the goddess Isis, because here, where stands the church of Saint-Germain-des-Prés, once stood the temple of Isis. And the Romans used to call this place Par Isis, which means near the temple of Isis. Parisis, Paris.
Napoleon was impressed enough to order the star and Isis herself placed on the prow of this ship in the emblem of Paris. The city harbors many references to Isis and Egypt, as on this ceiling of the Louvre Palace. It shows the genius of Paris to whom the future is unveiled, a future that shows Isis, an obelisk and a pyramid at her feet, and an angel heralding the vision.
And here it is, the very same statue towering over the Place de la Bastille, where to celebrate the first year of the revolution, huge crowds gathered here under a statue of Isis. And now, 200 years later, what is it looking at? Well, like in the painting, an obelisk and a pyramid, which was inaugurated in 1984 by President Mitterrand for the bicentennial of the revolution.
Here you have these extremely ancient magical devices placed in the heart of the power places of the world. You can imagine the millions of people walking around for years, and occasionally, it grabs the imagination of one. One person will say, well, why is it here? What's it doing here? And it's bound to evoke the magic of the past and what the symbol means.
Symbols which, like hieroglyphs, carry many layers of meaning. As it turned out in 1999, when Egypt had a brilliant idea to usher in a new millennium for television around the world to witness.
5 minutes before 12 o'clock, a helicopter will come with this cobblestone and will put it in the top of the pyramid. You know, you have to imagine, this will be the most exciting moment in history.
That capstone had been missing for thousands of years, and this seemed a marvelous stunt to promote Egypt. But this was a symbol with more to it.
There's been suggestion that, apart from it being a Masonic symbol, that it is going to represent the time when the Masonic ideals are brought to fruition and inaugurate a new world order. It's precisely what it says on the American dollar, that there is a new world order on its way.
Or, as an influential occult prophet, Edgar Cayce had foretold, the coming of a new Messiah. Or was it a new Horus? For the first time in thousands of years, Sirius, the birth star of Isis, would appear precisely above the pyramid at the very turn of the year. Ancient Egypt wrote Isis with two symbols, a star over a triangle. At the placing of the capstone at the turn of the millennium, the skies over Giza would have cried out, Isis, Isis.
You know, symbols have a funny way of causing changes of ideas, and therefore I'd like to see it, just because it pleases me to see it this way, as some sort of ancient magic, something we don't understand, something that is there to tease us and to remind us that all isn't rational, and that we live in a magical world that we haven't fully understood.
But Egypt celebrated the millennium without television worldwide. A radical Islamic press fiercely condemned the event as a capitalist plot and a coup of Freemasonry. The party went off without the capstone. Still, why do these symbols of the past still speak to us?
Egypt is important not because it's the sole place in the world where profound things happened, but because the decor of Egypt, you might say, startles us and reminds us that humanity in the past did fantastic things and had mystical and spiritual experiences that were important to its survival. And we want to reconnect with those experiences. And I believe that hunger exists very, very widely in our time.
The Giza Plateau, this expression of the Osirian religion and the Isis religion, was there before Christianity. It is there to stay. And it may even outlast Christianity.
Of a catastrophe which almost wiped out mankind. Was there something like a flood and something that went on before it? From the Middle Ages rises the myth of the Holy Grail, King Arthur and his round table. Was there something like a grail, a symbol for the church or for opponents which it feared? Peoples and gods of the Andes, how could the mightiest empire of its time fall for a handful of Spanish conquerors? The secret of the Incas and the lost war against time. The golem, the secrets of Kabbalah, Jewish myth, or man's longing to shape life and imitate the act of God. Ark of the Covenant, embodiment of God. Its sudden disappearance is one of the greatest mysteries from the Bible. Is the Ark still somewhere? From a nightmare arose a monster, Dracula.
How dare you touch him?
That man belongs to me.
How from fantasy and frustration, author Bram Stoker created a being which would become a myth.
Osiris King may traverse the Milky Way.
Osiris, Isis, Horus, the quest for eternity and life after death. Prototype for Christianity? The myths of ancient Egypt still reverberate today.
Hail the supreme sovereign, the Emperor Constantine, and the Empress Helena!
The year is 324. Constantine, the first emperor to embrace Christianity, has summoned the bishops to put an end to fierce theological debate.
There must have been a time before his creation when he was not
heretic.
3 centuries after Jesus of Nazareth walked the earth, quarrel rages about who and what he was. The decision the emperor imposes will define Christianity for 18 centuries to come.
Supreme Sovereign, fellow ministers, this is the creed to which we have unanimously declared ourselves signatories. We believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, begotten from the Father, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made.
By imperial decree, Jesus of Nazareth is proclaimed to be God's only Son. All other opinions are suppressed. Those disagreeing are exterminated.
The Dead Sea Scrolls speak of sons of God in a plural way. They are the perfect, and they are the people who are perfectly carrying out the law.
How would the historic Jesus have felt if he would have known that he would be termed the divine Son of God and only one.
I think he would have been horrified, completely horrified. It's the very opposite of everything that he would or could have represented in the Palestine that we're talking about.
10 years ago, historian Robert Eisenman forced the Dead Sea Scrolls into the open. Discovered in 1945 by a wandering shepherd, these documents offer a unique view on the world into which Jesus would be born. For the scrolls, Israel built this shrine of the book. Robert Eisenman found himself alone in his conclusion that they talk about Jesus, and that the man we see as God's son might have been a rebel rouser and fanatic. He is now virtually ignored. But fewer contested the words he then spoke at the end of a documentary I made on the scrolls, and for 10 years they kept on puzzling me. Who was Jesus? What was he?
Jesus was a Jew for all his life. He was born a Jew, he died a Jew. I think he would have been amazed at the construction of a Christian church.
Well, if we discovered this text today, that here was a guy who was born of a virgin, his mother was God, and he walked on water and then came back from the dead, we would all go, well, this is clearly a myth. And yet, because it's so much a part of our culture, part of our education, part of our upbringing, we call it the unthinkable thought. To think that this might actually be a myth is beyond most of us.
There was a biblical scholar, and probably a very devout Christian, writing at the beginning of the century, who said, we should no longer hope that the Jesus who actually lived in Palestine has any resemblance at all to the Jesus of the Bible. And I think that was a brutally honest statement and probably a correct statement.
For those who take the Bible as the very word of God, it may save pain and aggravation to turn this program off. It explores the thought that the creed stems from the realm of myth instead. A conviction growing among scholars as ancient documents come to light, which give new insight in the origins of Christianity, the ancient world, and Jesus, Son of God. In the world of Jesus, many could be sons of God, a term for the truly pious, Jews faithfully observing the law. The same for pagans.
The Son of God would have been terms used in the mysteries, but rather like we use the term, the doctor of theology, for instance, would have been entitled the Son of God, someone who had received information about the Godhead.
It's a metaphor which was available throughout the Roman world. It's a way of expressing a close relationship between a human and God. And Jesus was by no means the only Son of God around.
Everybody who was anybody, the emperors or anybody, claimed what was the Son of God and had a very similar biography of what they were able to do.
Son of God was not just a term reserved for the pious and knowledgeable, also for the powerful. In ancient Egypt, every pharaoh was a son of Osiris, Son of God.
You take Alexander the Great. Now, he is the person who brought the whole Mediterranean world together into a Greek empire. Now, his mother was an initiate of the cult of Dionysus. She groomed him with the idea that he was an immaculate conception, that born from the god. And in his life...
She was the virgin mother.
Indeed.
Julius Caesar is the son of the goddess with divine lineage, as all emperors later came to claim. So the idea of being Son of God is quite commonplace throughout the ancient world.
Did Jesus himself ever call himself the Son of God?
So far as we know, Jesus never referred to himself as Son of God. He, if we believe the Gospel of Mark, he spoke of himself as Son of Man.
Yet the claim that he was God's unique and only begotten son is the very cornerstone of the Christian creed. Over a distance of 2 millennia, Christianity seems to come as a radical break from the past, the promise of salvation, life after death. But did resurrection come as a new revelation to mankind with Jesus Christ?
No, on the contrary, but that is an idea that appealed very much to the Egyptians, who were always concerned about the eternal life of their body. And the pyramids and everything shows that the religion of the ancient Egyptians was life from death. And that was, of course, life in the cosmos after the death of nature in the spring.
Deep in his 80s, Dutchman Gilles Quispel, once professor at Harvard, is still considered one of the world's most eminent experts on ancient and early Christian thought.
The deceased appears for the tribunal of the last balance. And the man is standing there before the door that gives entrance to the hall of absolute truth. And there stands also Osiris.
He is a god who appears on the earth as a man. He brings great teachings, the proper way to worship the gods, brings civilization in a way, and then is put to death by the forces of evil. He is resurrected. He then ascends into heaven, where he will be the judge of souls at the end of time. And Egyptian tombs are full of representations of these events.
For ancient Egypt, Osiris stood as the constellation of Orion, good shepherd amongst the stars, souls in heaven. It is by no means the only mythic image that foretold the later concepts of Christianity. Authors Tim Freake and Peter Gandy made extensive study into ancient thought. It's a crude image. Why did you put this in front of your book?
Well, this piece of evidence was hugely important for us. It's a talisman, an amulet. It's tiny, the size of my thumb. And it shows what you think is Jesus on the cross. And yet the Greek inscription tells us that it's the pagan, dying and resurrecting god-man Dionysus. And the discovery that the pagan god-man could have met his death in exactly the same way that Jesus was later claimed to have died, for us was conclusive evidence that the Jesus story as we have it is taken from pagan mythology.
It says Bacchus, wasn't he the god of wine?
Indeed,
drinking?
Indeed, but also the god of initiation.
Originally no more than a minor wine deity, Dionysos, literally God's son, later transforms into a redeemer. A divine child seated in eerie resemblance to the infant Christ on his mother's lap. He is honored with bread and wine to commemorate his sacrifice and death on a crude stake. He resurrects and ascends to heaven, a Greek version of Osiris. Could Christianity owe something to this ancient culture and others?
On the site where the Vatican now stands, there once stood a pagan temple. Here, pagan priests celebrated sacred ceremonies which early Christians found so disturbing that they tried to erase all evidence of them ever having been practiced.
What were these shocking pagan rites? Gruesome sacrifices? Obscene orgies, perhaps? This is what we've been led to believe, but the truth is far stranger than this fiction.
In this ancient sanctuary, pagan congregations once glorified a redeemer, Mithras, who, like Jesus, was born on the 25th of December,
of a virgin, the Son of God, who ascended into heaven and promised to come again at the end of time to judge the quick and the dead. Here, pagan priests celebrated a symbolic meal of bread and wine in honor of their Redeemer.
The bread of Christ.
Who promised to his followers that he who shall not drink of my blood shall not know salvation.
Like Osiris in Egypt, Mithras, a deity with origins in Persia, stood in the skies as Orion, facing Taurus. His cult became the prime competitor of Christianity in the ancient world.
One famous scholar said that if Christianity hadn't triumphed, the whole world would have been Mithraic. Here is a deity who is a divine savior. He's the Son of God and a mortal woman.
He's God incarnate. He brings wisdom, he brings a new religion. He challenges, as the mystics always do, the old authorities. He's outrageous, he performs miracles, he turns water into wine at a wedding, just as Jesus does. He dies at Easter, he resurrects after 3 days, he ascends to heaven. And we've got lovely inscriptions saying, you know, if you share in the blood and the body of the God-man, then you too will be resurrected. So the motifs which we associate with the story of Jesus already exist in the story of Osiris Dionysus somewhere.
How do Christian authors, early Christian authors, explain away these similarities?
Well, there's two approaches. The early literalist Christians explain this through diabolical mimicry or plagiarism by anticipation. You know, it's the idea that somehow the devil has taken these ideas, because he knows they're going to happen, made up these myths over the centuries to mess with people's heads, so that when it actually happens in the form of Jesus, no one will believe it. Now, that's what the literalist Christians are saying. These Christians we don't actually find until the second century.
Christians celebrated their victory by claiming and pretending that paganism was decaying.
Crude, uninteresting, inferior.
And that Christianity simply had to win. But that was a Christian fantasy. In fact, paganism was passionately alive.
And what does pagan itself mean?
Well, it was coined by the Christians as a term of abuse. It means country dweller. So it was to suggest that these people who had built the pyramids, had given us the plays of Euripides and Sophocles, the works of Plato, were in some way primitive, superstitious country folk.
What transformed your opinion of paganism?
I think studying pagan spirituality and discovering this rich, mystical philosophy at the heart of it, this is where much that is of the best of what we now regard as Western culture comes from these roots, and finding that this form of spirituality wasn't at all this very primitive idol worship. It was incredibly sophisticated.
Catacombs. The images seem early Christian, but this good shepherd is in fact the Redeemer God Attis from Greek Asia.
Although the Christian message may seem revolutionary to love your enemies, and it is a far cry from the Judaic teachings of an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, but in pagan philosophy, we have sentiments that the philosopher's way is to be flogged like an ass and to love the man who beats you, to be a brother and a father to all mankind.
I was brought up, as I think most people in our culture have been, to have monotheism clearly on one side and then polytheism, monotheism being clearly superior. My view has been almost turned on its head, because what you find in pagan polytheism, that polytheism clearly has at its center the idea of oneness. There is a one God, or even a oneness which is beyond any idea of God even, and that is the supreme being which can be approached through many faces. And the reason that this impersonal oneness needs these many faces is because any one face is inadequate to the glory of this oneness.
An example, India, land of thousands of gods and goddesses.
Yet any Hindu can tell you that all these are merely as many facets of the One, that all is one, divine, limitless, and incomprehensible to man.
What happens with monotheism is that you get the idea that there was one way. One particular face glorified as if that was the one God. In our culture, that's Yahweh or Jehovah, the Jewish tribal God, who is a particular face of God, if you like, a particular way that a people were relating to the divine, and said, no, this is the personality of God. And this is one of the ways in which Christianity became an authoritarian religion. Form of spirituality, because it allows diversity, because it knows that what it's trying to take you to ultimately can't be expressed, has no qualities, is a mystical understanding, and therefore any route you take is going to be personal. The polytheism or the monotheism, these really are not the issues. It blinds you to the real perspective. It's how they're understood which is crucial.
How did the ancients try to understand the mystery of life? Most is lost, destroyed, but crucial seem to be ideas, also voiced by the Greek thinker Plato. Man, said Plato, is like someone in a cave, bound, unable to see anything else than what is before his eyes, vague shapes on the wall. Shadows that the light casts from the real world that goes on behind him.
He's the one.
But man, unable to turn, blind to a real, divine world, keeps on staring at the wall before him, thinking that truth is there, believing that only that is his reality. Learning to see that true divine world was the quest of the mystery religions.
Mystery religion aims at transformation. That is the basic idea of the mystery.
They sought to transform, to see true reality, true knowledge, what they called gnosis.
All the mystery religions really had an outer, exoteric, outer mysteries and inner mysteries, more mystical teachings about self-transformation. And the outer mysteries really are there for, they talk about cooking for the masses, you know, it's something which is available to all.
But others saw a deeper, mystical reality under the surface of the story. To them, the story was an allegory which told not just about the God, but beyond that, about themselves, a deeper message which taught them to understand the mystery of life and face the reality of death.
And then what we find then is a spectrum between two extremes, which we call literalists on the one hand or Gnostics and mystics on the other. That the Gnostics or the mystics, pagan philosophers, you know, they're attacking their own literalists or fundamentalists who literally believe that worshipping an idol will help you and all the rest of it. They're going, no, this is a complete misunderstanding. We're saying that there is an essential mystical understanding of the miracle and the mystery of life, and the language with which this is expressed varies. Now, one of the ways that it's expressed was allegory in mythic picture language and stories. And the one which is key, of course, to understanding Christianity is the myth of the Son of God. And that goes right the way back to the ancient Egyptians and Osiris and develops up through figures such as Dionysus in Greece, Attis, Adonis, Mithras, and so forth. Many, many different figures. What we would say is that exactly the same process then continued right the way through up until the first century, where the Jews did exactly the same thing and took their mythic figure, the Messiah, Joshua, Jesus, and transformed him likewise into this dying and resurrecting God-man.
To his companions, Jesus of Nazareth was a man who taught the deepest truth. Were they Gnostics? Mystics who fit his life and death into a Gnostic framework, Did Jesus become their symbol for a deeper message, an inner truth?
A figure in an allegory through which you can be transformed through initiation, and that at the end of that you can come to gnosis or knowledge, this mystical state of enlightenment.
Belief in the Jesus story was originally only a first step in Christian spirituality, the outer mystery. The significance was to be explained by an enlightened teacher when the student was spiritually ripe, a mystical knowledge of God beyond mere dogma. Although there are many great Christian mystics of later centuries who have intuitively seen through to this deeper symbolic level, as a culture we've kept only the outer mysteries. It seems to me we have kept the form, but we have lost the meaning.
The only contemporary to write about him is the historian Josephus, and then only a few words, which may have been even inserted much later. The Bible describes Jesus in most extensive detail, but the Gospels seem to vary and even contradict. Take the crucial moment when his believers hear their Lord has resurrected. Mark reports a man in white announcing it to three women. Luke has three men and three women encounter two angels. In Matthew, two women see one angel. And in John, only Mary Magdalena sees two angels.
There's no consensus, even within the New Testament, on the form of the resurrection. In the late second century, some argued that you had to believe not only that Jesus was somehow alive, but that it was actually a physical, corporeal resuscitation of his body. And that conviction has been enshrined in the creeds, but it's not part of the early Christian movement. It's very hard to speak about the historical Jesus, but the Gospels, they weren't written for that purpose, of course. They're not historical writings. They're written in the form of biography. But their purpose is not to tell us about the historical Jesus. It's to tell us about their convictions that this man was God's Messiah, and to persuade us of that by all means possible. And so they are religious teachings, not historical writings.
The Gospels are books of belief constructed to sound as though they're history, and the historicity of Jesus is a core element in the appeal to truth. Here I'm telling you a true story. But it's highly unlikely that the Gospels are contemporary records. The Gospels were written in the cities of the Eastern Mediterranean.
And in Greek, by educated men, not by the fishermen who are recorded as the followers of Jesus in the Gospels.
And they were written decades after Christ, when the memory of his life and suffering was fading, around a time which came as a watershed, the Jewish rising and total destruction of Israel by Rome, annihilating anyone who might still have known Jesus himself. Mark, Luke, and Matthew wrote their Gospels almost two generations after Jesus. The fourth, John's Gospel, came even almost three generations later, and they weren't the only Gospels.
We know that there were many, many Gospels that followers of Jesus read, wrote, revered, and many other writings too, letters, epistles, poems, hymns, and so forth. Today we look at Christianity and it looks very diverse. Everything from Baptist to Russian Orthodox to Calvinist, Roman Catholic, you know, an enormous range. But when you look at the first century, probably the range was even greater because there was no fixed canon of New Testament scriptures. There was no creed that was agreed upon by Christians throughout the world, and there was no specific structure. So what strikes me as fascinating is that the groups one sees as Christian are, if anything, more diverse than they are today.
Jesus, his companions, and first followers were Jews, Judaic Christians. What these original Christians, closest to the teachings of Jesus, thought, has for many centuries been obscured, but now ancient documents have appeared which shed light on their beliefs. Gilles Quispel played a crucial role in opening them up to science, and what they reveal is stunning.
The Judaic Christians were silent about the saving value of the sacrifice of Christ on the cross. There is no virginal birth, no resurrection, no cross, but only just the words of Jesus, who is there, the embodiment of divine wisdom.
A holy man, not a god, but a man of profoundest wisdom.
They believed that Jesus was an enlightener, an illuminator.
A man who showed the way to the divine. His first followers seemed to adhere to an altogether different religion. Basic concepts of later Christianity were strange to them. But well after the memory of Jesus had faded and those who remembered him had died, times came when Jesus Christ was iconized into God's only Son, and ideas and rites arose which might have amazed Jesus and his companions.
Celebrating his birth on the 24th or 25th of December comes from the birthday of the sun god Mithra, because that is the solstice, and that's the time when the sun is born again, the newborn sun. The birthday of the invincible sun god, celebrated by the Romans, later was taken by Christians as the birthday of Jesus.
It also becomes a miraculous divine birth.
Well, it's very interesting, isn't it, that the miraculous conception of Jesus, the divine birth, the virgin birth, is central, particularly for Catholics, as a part of Christian belief. But of course, in the Gospel of Mark, the earliest Gospel, none of this story is told, nor is it told in the Gospel of John.
To those who believe in a God being born, divine birth and immaculate conception become central issues. But was Jesus born the same time as the divine Christ was?
That's an interesting question.
Among ancient Christians, there was a real division of opinion as to when Jesus becomes divine.
According to Mark, the Spirit of God descended on him as the Spirit descended on the prophets of old. And he became a person inspired by the Spirit. And at that point, a voice from heaven proclaimed him to be God's chosen one, in fact, his son.
Divine insight came on Jesus when he was a man. To many Christians who cling to divine birth and the dogma of immaculate conception, it may come as a surprise that Jesus, in fact, had brothers.
The Gospel of Mark tells us that Jesus had brothers and sisters who were well known in their hometown. And I think later, Christians became troubled by this. So they were taken to be the children of Joseph by a previous marriage. However, the Gospel of Mark suggests nothing of the kind.
Jerusalem, this Armenian cathedral, was built over the remains of one of Jesus's brothers, James, though the church prefers not to call him that.
This is a sanctuary in the name of Saint James, the brother of the Lord, who was a cousin to Jesus by Joseph, and he was the first bishop of Jerusalem, and his remnant was under the main altar.
Lately, this small sandstone coffin has come to light, marked James, son of Joseph, brother of Joshua, Jesus. Through this brother, one realizes something crucial about Jesus, for James was a key figure in Jerusalem of the time.
James, the brother of Jesus, was the leader of the Jesus movement from the death of Jesus until 61. There's only one very brief paragraph in the historian Josephus writing at the end of the first century about the death of James. And it says quite clearly that a wildcat Sadducee high priest assassinated James and was removed from his position as high priest by the majority of the priests who objected, by the Pharisees, who were the friends of James, the brother of Jesus. It is quite extraordinary, because in this account, the Pharisees are on the side of the Jesus movement, not, as they're reported in the Gospels, as the enemies. So, for 25 years or so, the Jesus movement is an acknowledged Jewish movement associated with fervent Jews worshipping at the temple. And it's the destruction of the temple in 70 which knocks out the heart of the Jewish Jesus movement. But until then, most Christians in my book were Jews.
Jews who would found their Messiah. All Jews hope for the coming of a holy man, a Messiah. God would help with heavenly hosts to liberate the people of Israel from foreign oppression. But Jesus was a different Messiah. He taught that salvation can be found within oneself.
The Gospel of Thomas suggests that Jesus is the illuminated one. Like a Buddha, he is the enlightened one, not different from anyone else, but one who has realized the deepest potential, the spiritual potential of human nature.
Yes, according to the Jewish Christians, yes. But if you say that sounds like the enlightenment of Buddha, I would say that you are right. I personally would say Jesus is, for me as a Christian, the light of the world. But the concept of an enlightened man is the same.
A man of deepest wisdom, enlightened, but a man, no God. A son of God to Jews as they considered other holy men. At what point then was he iconized into God's only begotten son? Declared dogma when the creed was formalized by Constantine 300 years later.
We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, begotten from the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made.
Of the four Gospels in the New Testament, of course, the latest to be written was the Gospel of John. And the Gospel of John is the only one that speaks of Jesus as a divine being, as himself divine, as God in human form, and particularly as the only begotten Son of God. It's quite a remarkable and radical view that one man was God incarnate. And startlingly, that unusual gospel, which actually in the early Christian movement I cannot find mentioned among Orthodox Christians before about the year 160, becomes the lens through which Christians later read all the Gospels. So many Christians today will think, well, of course, Christianity means Jesus is the Son of God. But that's not what you find in Matthew, Mark, or Luke so much. You find in those the teaching that Jesus is God's Messiah, the one who redeems his people, the one who teaches the way of righteousness. One could be a very devout Jew and follow Jesus at that point. But with the Gospel of John, the claim that Jesus is God's son, and more than that, his only son, that radical claim in the Gospel of John changes the understanding of the Christian message in a dramatic way.
Rising debate over the nature of Jesus, whether a man or divine, transforms early Christianity as the movement widens. A growing belief in the messenger more than the message. It may have changed Christianity more profoundly than the change brought about by another man who is usually seen as the great divide, Paul.
Paul was retrospectively constructed as the hero who founded, refounded the Christian church. But Paul always tried to recruit believers in the synagogue. Very sensible too, then the Jews knew half the story. But he was also willing to recruit Gentiles. The radical break that Paul made was to allow non-Jews to eat with Jews and not follow kosher laws. And that was a radical break, to be inclusive, to allow everyone to believe in Jesus. It was a fantastic step.
Paul is a completely misconceived character in history. Paul is, at the time of Paul, we would say that there is no split between Gnosticism and literalism, because literalism hasn't developed. There is no literal Jesus at this time.
Paul is existing before the literal story. He's writing before the gospel, and Paul doesn't have a gospel story. Paul's Christology is very, very unique and very spiritual.
Paul, amazingly, says that he received his teaching from a revelation in which a being of light appeared to him, and he was convinced it was Jesus. He knew little about him, but
never
then
talks about Jesus.
He doesn't talk about Jesus, and he says if once we knew Jesus according to the flesh, that doesn't matter anymore now. What matters is the risen Christ.
Paul says that Christ was revealed
in me, not to me.
What does that mean?
When he's talking, yes, I mean, this is fascinating. If he's talking about, you know, his vision of light, he doesn't meet the Jesus that we're familiar with from the gospel story, who had a mother and father, and all of that is not important to Paul. What he meets is a being of light, just as exactly the pagans had met their gods as beings of light. And then when he talks about the great secret that has been revealed, is not that Jesus came, was born just down the road, and did all these miraculous things. What he says is, this is the great secret, Christ in you. And when he talks about Christ being revealed, it wasn't revealed to him, Christ was revealed in him. Now this is what makes Paul's Christianity so completely Gnostic and not
Why?
Literal.
What would two mean?
Because the literalist approach is that Jesus is outside of you, God is outside of you, God is outside of the universe indeed. It's separate. Whereas the Gnostic approach and the ancient pagan approach of the mysteries is that all is one. If you could put it in a nutshell, it's just that. All is one. And so Christ is in you, you are in Christ. You can say it either way you like, but you can't divide it up. And that's what the literalist church does.
How different the writings of Paul are becomes steadily more obvious through the sensational discovery of a hoard of documents, unknown gospels, hidden when a Christian church on the rise persecuted their readers. Gnostic Gospels, discovered half a century ago in Nag Hammadi, Egypt. Misunderstood, maltreated at first, fallen into the hands of black traders, scientists now realize what they imply.
The books from Nag Hammadi are more important than the Dead Sea Scrolls, because they throw a new light on the history of Christianity, on Jesus, and on God. Didymus, Judas, Thomas, our Patshav,
by far the most important gospel was written by a Didymus, Judas, Thomas.
Who was Didymus, Judas, Thomas?
Didymus Judas Thomas was one of the brothers of Jesus.
Later church tradition makes of Thomas the apostle who could not believe Jesus after his death came back in the flesh, resurrected as a physical body, wounds, stigmata, and all.
The doubting Thomas, who is now said to be the most faithful disciple of his master.
Who best understood his brother.
According to the Gospel of Thomas, yes.
The document ascribed to Thomas, though written down later, is now believed to go back before the canonized Gospels, and is thought to reflect closely the time when the teachings of Jesus were fresh and alive.
I find it astonishing, really, that the Christians haven't run out everywhere and wanting to read the Gospel of Thomas and all these other marvellous scriptures which have come to light. And I think it says something about how powerful the hold of the Roman Church was, that it's still pushed outside, they're still regarded as heretical and dangerous. And of course, they are heretical and they are dangerous from the perspective of the literalist church, because they turn the understanding of the literalist church inside out.
They tell us about a variety of ways in which people believed that you could find salvation by contemplating, by expanding the divine spark that's buried in each of us, communicating with God by searching inside one's own soul, an individual pursuit of the divine without the help of priests or bishops.
Sounds attractive.
Gnosticism is amazingly attractive. I think particularly attractive to the modern mind, because it sells a religion for the individual, not a religion brought about by a church. I think it's all out. I think this is what humans have always looked for, yearned for, to try and find divinity by themselves. But that's to oversimplify, because it is also extraordinarily complicated. In many ways, if you read it, it's like having a bath in a thousand soap bubbles and getting the soap into your eyes. It's blinding, it's obscuring, as well as cleansing.
It was already there in the Egyptian religion when they said 3,000 before Christ that man, after his life, became Osiris. He was integrated into the Godhead. It was the basic concept of all mysteries that existed in the Roman Hellenistic world. The mysteries of Isis, of Mithras, of Adonis, everything. That was the idea. There was in man a divine spark hidden unconsciously in him, and that was to be awakened by the initiation which led ultimately to transformation.
How did it get lost?
Well, that is very simple. The Catholics had a bulldozer, and the rabbis had a bulldozer too. And that summarizes in a few words the whole history of Christianity and Judaism.
You know, if you want to build a church, you have to say that no, salvation is only possible by, with, from, and through the church and God's representative on earth, who is the Pope, and that is the only way. Whereas the Gnostics are very much, it's about you can do it right now, right here, and you don't need the authority of the bishop.
If you want to understand what Christianity is actually about and what paganism is actually about, is to understand that it's a journey of self-knowledge. And what they're looking for is the part of you which cannot die. It's not that you're going to be granted something you don't already have. It's discovering that you are already immortal, because your essence is not the body. We mistake ourselves as these individual bodies with all of the problems that come with that. And the whole of the story is we need to die to the identity of the body, which is on the cross of matter, and we need to resurrect to our true identity, which is the Son of God, which is the Christ or the Osiris Dionysus.
In that sense, we are all sons of God.
We are all sons of God if we realize our true identity.
And in that sense, The whole myth, the whole story of the crucifixion of Christ and the resurrection is a model to all and each of us.
A model, yes, precisely. It's a model which can take you through this initiation.
For the Gnostics, their whole quest was a continuation of the pagan quest. Know thyself was written over at the Oracle of Delphi. And this was the quest of Plato and of Socrates, and to know what you... And the Gnostics continued that quest. And by its nature, it was difficult. You had to go through the experience. There was no way you could bypass it. Now, once you've got it turned into a religion, which is pretty much off the shelf, all you have to do is believe that this person has done it for you, and you will get to heaven. You just have to believe in Jesus and you will get to heaven. For the Gnostics, it's actually about becoming Christ yourself with all of the suffering and effort that involves. A completely different religion, and one can see, I mean, having studied Gnosticism, one can see why Christianity triumphed. It was kind of inevitable.